Hello, section Introduction to the Serverless Cluster AWS Services. In this video, what is serverless cluster processing? We will cover serverless and cluster approach and how it changes the way we deploy applications. Let's start by looking into the specter of possible ways of application deployment. On the left, we have on-premise deployment, where we control the whole stack, including hardware. To put it simply, it means that the application runs on our machine, which we can physically reach. Secondly, we have infrastructure as a service, which means that we don't have servers within our grasp, but we control everything what is happening on it. Next, we have platform as a service, where we don't control operating system or runtime, but we can control our code and container. Finally, we have function as a service, where the only thing we control is the code itself. Don't worry, this is good news since it will enable us to do tremendous applications. Within the course, we will look more in depth on three parts: function as a service, container as a service, and platform as a service. Let's take a closer look at all of them. Serverless term can be pretty broad, but generally speaking, it is about managing your application without the need to manage the server layer. Here are the example services which allows us to do that. Function as a service, as we only need to configure code libraries for application to work. AWS Lambda and Google Cloud Functions are examples of this kind of service. Container as a service, as we only need to configure container image without need for managing underlying virtual machines. AWS Batch, AWS Fargate, and Google Cloud Run are the examples of this kind of service. And finally, platform as a service, as we can use scalable services which can handle state, as two previous approaches are focused on the stateless execution. AWS, Step Functions, and Azure Logic Apps are the examples of platform as a service. Let's take a more in-depth look at function as a service. The main difference of VAS from container as a service is that we don't have to define container image and can just work with code and libraries. Also, in most implementations, VAS has faster startup time and better scalability. Usual function as a service, for example AWS Lambda, works in the following way. It keeps Lambda configuration, which is basically code, libraries, and parameters within the service. Once it receives the trigger request, it takes container from the pool and puts configuration inside the container. Then it runs the code inside the container with the data from the event trigger. Once the container produces a result, service returns it in the response. If new request comes within the next 10 to 15 minutes, Lambda will use existing container, which will process incoming request faster. This is called warm execution, in contrast to cold execution, which happened during the initial request. Lambda scales automatically, up to 10,000 concurrent executions, so you don't have to worry about that. Also, Lambda pricing is pay-as-you-go, so you only pay for each run of the Lambda and don't pay when it doesn't run. One of the main advantages of function as a service is that they can be easily integrated with other public cloud services. For example, there are various AWS services which can act as trigger for AWS Lambda. DynamoDB, meaning we can start Lambda function on each new entry to the database. S3, meaning Lambda function will start on new file in the bucket. CloudWatch, which enable us to run Lambda functions according to the schedule, for example, each minute, each day, or only at noon each Thursday. Lex, which is AWS platform for chatbots. AWS Lambda, in this case, runs as a backend for the chatbot. Finally, Kinesis, SQS, and SNS, which enable us to start Lambda function on each object in the event stream. As you can see, there are a lot of different triggers, which means that we can bind Lambda with a lot of different services. Let's take a look at how Lambda configuration looks like. Lambda configuration consists of the following. First is just our code, which we want to run within the function. Code needs to have explicit declaration of the function which we want service to run. Next are libraries, which enable us to run more complicated processing. We need to keep them inside the same package as the code itself. Finally, there are various parameters which dictate how Lambda works. The main parameters are available operational memory and timeout. Next are runtime, for example Python or Node, triggers, which we described before, IAM role, which provides Lambda access to other AWS services, and environmental parameters, which allows us to customize input parameters to our code. Now let's go through the organization of the code on VAS, specifically on AWS Lambda. Usually it consists of the following parts. Importing libraries which already exist on AWS Lambda. This includes system libraries and a number of AWS-specific libraries. we don't have to include these libraries within our package. Importing outside libraries, which come from other developers and companies or our own libraries, we have to put them inside our package. Handler function, which handles processing of the request. It receives two main variables as an input, event and context. Event is trigger specific information, input request for API gateway, notification for SNS or SQS, or chat message for Lex. Context is information about Lambda, which handles request. It contains ID and parameters for the function. Code itself, which processes the request. One thing to keep in mind is that you cannot use any context or state other than the one which comes from the trigger. Also, if you print something during the code execution, it will be saved to the log stream of the function. And the return of the result, which will either be provided back to the trigger in case of the synchronous execution or just saved to the log. To summarize, there are certain pros, cons, and limitations which FAS has. As for the pros, FAS is very easy to deploy. You don't have to know Docker or other container framework to manage it. It should only contain libraries and code. FAS is very easy to connect to triggers. It means that we can easily integrate it with other parts of cloud infrastructure. FAS is very scalable, and you don't have to create your own logic for scaling. That makes it extremely useful for production deployment. It has pay-as-you-go model and is relatively cheap. For the cons, it may be very hard to debug FAS locally. You have to recreate the whole environment and libraries and also be able to check your memory consumption and timeout. The more container logic, which I have mentioned before, isn't documented with specific durations, and there is no way to monitor it. This makes it very hard to make good estimations of how fast you will be able to process high peak loads. FAS is stateless, and it affects a lot how you organize your application. It means that the state should come from the trigger. As for the limits, there are RAM, disk, CPU, and timeout limits, which we have to keep in mind during our development process. Thank you for listening. This concludes the end of this video.